Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 15 of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. No guests this week, just me. Every fifth episode, we're going to do a solo cast where it's just you and me. And this week, we're going to talk about the Internet of Things versus the Internet of You. That's the Internet of Things versus the Internet of You and the implications of that. So, fun fact about myself, I am a cord-cutting millennial. What does that mean? That means I cut the cord from cable. I do not have cable TV at home. I have internet from Comcast, but not Comcast cable, and I get all of my programming either directly on my laptop or in the TV through my Roku cast. And you also have Amazon Fire Prime TV and Chromecast from Google. And so, like most millennials, Netflix takes the lion's share of my programming. And I oscillate between Netflix, Hulu, and Sling TV. It really just depends on what I'm binge watching at the time. But there's this show on Netflix called Black Mirror. It's actually out of the UK, and it recently just got on Netflix. It's already in its third season. And Black Mirror is similar to The Twilight Zone. So every episode is an hour long, and it's its own self-contained episode. And there's usually some really dark twist at the end where the plot line just, you know, goes haywire. So anyway, the show as a whole, it's future based. It's set in the not so distant future, and it's really technologically advanced, but they're sort of technophobes because, like I said, because it's Twilight Zone-esque, they tend to go dark with it. And so, It's nice. It's a good show. I'm not going to spoil it for you, but it tends to go more on the dark side of the future. But it's a really cool show visually to watch, just how they depict things and how they show it. So anyway, season 3, episode 1 is titled Nosedive. And in this episode, which I will not spoil for you, please do go to Netflix and check it out. I will give you a short exposition, though. They have the internet and the contact lenses. So everyone has a pair of internet-enabled contact lenses, and everyone has a smartphone. So when you look at somebody, you immediately see in your eye, in your retinal display, their name, you know, what they do. And they also have a community scoring system, not unlike our credit rating. But instead of a FICO score, they have a credit rating that goes from 0 to 5. And every time you have a social interaction with somebody, you can rate them with your smartphone and assign a rating to them. And this takes, you know, social cred literally. Like, instead of it just being a nice concept online, it actually affects the way that these people live their lives. It affects what type of job you can get. It affects where you can live and all this other good stuff. And so, and again, it's kind of like The Twilight Zone, so it does not have a happy ending. But you should watch it because it goes off the rails in a really spectacular way. But this depiction of the future, this having the internet enabled in your contact lens, this is not far off from most futurist predictions of the future. There is this physicist and futurist called Michio Kaku, really famous in that space. He did a video on bigthink.com. That's bigthink.com. I will link that up in the show notes. And he talks about pretty much what this episode of Black Mirror is talking about. He doesn't go, you know, into the complete timeline, you know, the complete plot of it, but it's very conceivable that in the not so distant future, you will have internet enabled contact lenses, where as soon as you look at somebody, you see their name and all the information associated with them. And if they talk in a different language, it will automatically translate it into whatever language you speak. And so This is, it's science fiction now, but there's a lot of things from Star Trek, like back in the day with, Captain Kirk and Spock that we actually have now. And so it's not as far off as you would think. And so Black Mirror is not alone in painting a very dystopian picture of the future. Another good book that I highly recommend everybody in the digital marketing space read is called The Circle. And I will link that up in the show notes as well. And I don't like spoiling things for people because I want you to go out and watch the show on Netflix, and I want you to go out and buy the book. But I listened to The Circle, an audiobook, and the quick rundown of it is if Google and Facebook had a baby, it would be called The Circle. And they form this, for lack of a better term, one world company where they eventually take over the world in a pretty spectacular fashion. And it's kind of, just like Black Mirror, kind of dark, but really thought provoking. And it's a good conversation starter. But I, on the other hand, I am not so bleak about the Internet of Things. One, because it's already here. It just hasn't been very widely adopted yet. The Internet of Things, as I'm recording this in early 2017, has actually been around for a couple of decades. And it's just right now it's becoming more commercially acceptable, but it's nowhere near the level of where it could go because you have Snapshot from Progressive. So you stick this thing in your car and it observes your driving behavior. And if you're deemed to be a safe driver, then they will give you a discount on your car insurance, which is a scam, by the way. Like you have to get the stuff. And I, knock on wood, this isn't wood, but whatever it is, I've never been in a car accident. So I have to pay every month. And I live in Atlanta and car insurance is expensive in Atlanta because there are a lot of car accidents. I've never been in one. So I gotta pay like $250 a month every month for a service that I never use. Anyway, you have that, and you have the smart fridges, right? The fridge that can monitor what's in your refrigerator and alert you to make a shopping list every time you're low on certain things. You can then send that shopping list to a grocery shopping service and have somebody deliver your groceries. Or once this finally gets off the ground, you can actually have Amazon deliver groceries via drone. Right. And then you also have the video doorbells that go directly to your smartphones. You can monitor who's approaching your house while you're away. And then you have the whole house systems like Nest that can control the thermostat, that can turn things on and turn things off. And you can literally control your entire house from your smartphone. Like these things are here now. Like as I'm recording this, 2017, right now, today. A lot of people don't have them. A lot of people can't afford them. But like with any adoption curve, as time goes on, these things will become more commercially viable for more people. But the reason I don't go as dark and sinister as Black Mirror or The Circle is because going back to the futurist Michio Kaku, artificial intelligence, it's really good at repetition. It's good at doing things that are just, repetition, the same thing over and over and over again, and calculating things very fast. They're very poor at understanding just the basics of human behavior. Like they know what water is, but they don't know that water is wet. They don't know that strings pull, but they can't push. And so, to Michio Kaku's point in the video on bigthink.com, which again I'll link up, he talks about how if you have a job that's repetitious, that's just the friction of commerce, doing the same thing over and over again, that's gone, that's obliterated. There are even factories as we speak that are completely automated because they just do the same thing over and over and over again, which is something that computers are very well suited to do. How However, if you are involved in things that involve pattern recognition or understanding human behavior, like gardening or being a detective, those jobs aren't going anywhere. At least not anytime soon, because these are things that computers are not well suited for. Because again, it involves creativity, it involves out of the box thinking. And for as great as these machines are, they're still programmed by a human being, at least now anyway. And until that changes, it's not time to get scared of Skynet just yet. Not saying that that couldn't happen at some point. It's just that we're not there yet. We're going to take a short break, and when we get back, I'm going to go in further deeper about the Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, that sort of thing. And so stay with me. This is going to be a really fun episode. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog, course. And we're back. So, picking up where I left off, there are very serious privacy concerns, however, and this is especially something that needs to be on most marketers' radar, because when you talk about the Internet of Things and everything being connected via mobile devices, you quickly get into a quagmire when it comes to PII, which is personally identifiable information, right? The system that we have now is based on informed consent, but when everything has a sensor on it and your information is getting passed off a billion different times just through a course of the day, like what does that even look like and what are the informed consent implications? So the whole basis of informed consent is based on two principles. One, that you know whom you're giving access to your information, and you know roundabout what they're going to do with it, right? When we live in a connected society in the Internet of Things, that becomes increasingly more complicated. So take smart city initiatives, right? Forget about, having Amazon deliver your groceries to you via drone. Say you live in a larger city like New York or San Francisco or even Atlanta, and you utilize public transportation, right? So you hail an Uber or you get a driverless car. The car knows you're inside of it and it knows which route is going and everything like that. So every time you stop at a stop sign, your information is getting registered with the stop sign or at the stoplight. And then you go to the train station via your smartphone or your watch. It registers as you enter the train station while you're on the train and as you go about your day. And each and every time you meet a checkpoint, which are going to be everywhere, your information gets passed off, and it also gets passed off to secondary systems that you're not aware of. And so, like, what happens if you get into a car accident? Do the authorities have the right to monitor your activities inside of the car, say whether or not you were speeding? And the chain of command of your information gets exponentially more complicated with each and every touch point, because again, you opted in. The whole premise of the opt-in process is, again, knowing who you're giving your information to in roundabout how they're going to use it. But if that gets passed and swiped off between, stoplights and stop signs, which then go to somewhere else, which then gets switched to another place, with every level of interaction, the complexity goes up exponentially to the point where you really don't know what the outcome is going to be. So how then can you give informed consent if you don't know who your information is going to get to and how they're going to use it? The answer is that you can't. You can't give informed consent under those circumstances because there are too many unknowns, because that rabbit hole can shake its way out a number of ways. I listen to a podcast called The Marketing Companion. It's hosted by Mark Schaefer, who's a friend of the show and has been on the show before, and Tom Webster. And they very rarely have on guests. Like, if Mark is at a conference or something, he might, pull somebody to the side and talk to him real quick. But they very rarely have an entire episode with a designated guest. And they broke code a few months back and had on Professor Ari Lightman from Carnegie Mellon University here in the United States. And it is a phenomenal episode. Like, I'm not even gonna go into the whole "I won't spoil it for you" thing. I'm just gonna go tell you straight up, go listen to it. But one of the things that he brings to light, which is really exceptional, is he teaches at Carnegie Mellon, and he doesn't call it the Internet of Things. He calls it the Internet of Threats to his security students, because a lot of these systems are very secure in and of their own right, except when they're being patched or when they're downloading a systems upgrade, right? So think of your smartphone. Your smartphone has very good security in it, in and of itself, but when you have to download an app, during that download process, that is when you are susceptible to attack, and that is when you're susceptible to threat. So going back to these whole house systems like Nest, that literally can control everything in your house that's connected. If a smart hacker can figure out when you're due for a systems upgrade, there's nothing stopping them from, hacking into your system as you're downloading the upgrade. They just sort of piggyback on the download, and they're in, and they have access to everything, like absolutely everything. And if you're a little cynical, like listening to this podcast might suggest, you're a little disenchanted like I am. You're probably thinking about, so why does this matter to me? So what? I don't have a whole house system. That's not in the cards for me anytime soon. You probably have more mobile devices in your house than you think. So, by definition, a mobile device is anything that can receive a wireless signal. I'm going to repeat that. A mobile device is anything that can receive a wireless signal. Now think about that for a sec. It's not just your phone. It's your watch. It's your television. It's anything with a wire that can receive a wireless signal. So just think about how many sensors you have in your house. You probably have upwards of 10, if not more. Right? So you have your smartwatch, you have your smartphone, you have your laptop, you have your television, you have your tablet, if you have any of those. I still have, before, the iPhone and other phones stepped up their camera games, used to have point and click cameras and video camcorders. Those have largely been absorbed into smartphones, but I still have a point and click HD camera. I still have a Kodak ZI-8 video camcorder. All of these things can receive a mobile signal, and all of them are considered mobile slash connected devices. And so these things have kind of quietly entered our lives to the point that we don't even think about them. They're so ubiquitous, it's just an everyday part of life. But if it can receive a wireless signal, it is in fact a mobile device. And so, why do I talk about this? Why do I bring this up on a podcast about marketing and what you need to know? Well, the whole thing about the podcast is, uplifting the profile of the professional digital marketer. And the whole conversation about privacy and personally identifiable information, this is something that needs to be talked about to a much wider extent because I, for one, I was until about a year ago now, I was completely oblivious. I fashioned myself a mobile connoisseur because I knew about SMS text message marketing and beacons and watches and all that sort of thing. But the whole conversation around security, it just really never entered my realm because it's like, well, they're opting into the text messages and I'm marketing to them via text. And so, it's something that if you don't really take time to think through, I think here in a little bit, we can quickly find ourselves in a legal quagmire. And I don't have the answer by any means. This is just a bug I'm leaving in your ear to really think through what the future might look like. Again, I'm not as bearish on the future as Black Mirror or The Circle, but I really do encourage you guys to go watch that program, listen to the audio book, buy the physical book if that's what you're into still, and just think through some of the implications because this is going to affect the way all of us live our lives in the near future. And so, that's about it. Hopping off my soapbox. This has been another solo cast, episode 15 of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. And if you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.